they may also hook you up to.
Because they record these talks.
Should I put the computer here? It's better or here?
It doesn't matter. Yeah, I'll pin a microphone on you when we're close to starting.
It's more because it's I use.
You need a clicker?
If you have it, yeah. The mine, because, I mean, I have one which doesn't work well, so. You may have a little
point. It needs a laser pointer in the middle. Green.
Yes.
We should test it.
Some just have the perfect grasping.
Yeah, because a lot of times things don't always work. And
yeah.
A lot of times you've got to go out for a beer or stay up and look up and want to talk about movies. You know,
yeah.
And just keep the focus and self-reliance.
Yeah.
You don't want to do this by yourself.
Yeah.
That's good. That's good. How many people does Evelyn have?
Right now it's 5 of us.
Are you the senior?
No, there's one more person who's a year above me. So, yeah.
Yeah, Melanie said he met, so she's on vacation next Wednesday, Thursday, Friday.
Right.
You're
good.
How are you?
Good, how are you?
Good.
Alright, I'm gonna Google Professor Capillaro stuff just in case Naomi does not make it appear.
There's probably some on this floor somewhere. Oh, there's a kitchen, I think.
Yeah, there's a kitchen on there.
Can I?
Yes, I did.
Can you look at some just so it looks different on my computer?
Yeah.
I think it's stretching for some reason.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Okay. You might move it.
Yeah.
I'll get you a cup of water.
Yeah, I can. Yeah, we can go to the kitchen.
Yeah.
looks fine in there, but oh, you have one. Okay, yeah.
I don't know what you need to know.
Yeah, let's see.
I saw Severo's talk on the Tallahassee.
Did you?
Yeah, I saw you, I saw your name, and I believed your story about your name.
Yeah.
That's what it's mine.
Of course, you have to pronounce it as Kanye.
Yeah. Or your word. No, I don't think the rest of the audience got that joke. No.
You can try the 100 by
600.
I think young people are more...
Yeah.
Like,
yeah,
the
older...
I don't think it was joking, like... Just, like, I think that's... What he thinks my name is supposed
no,
to
no, no, yeah, no, he didn't pot, no, there's no pot, he just said, oh, it's not my name. I was like, oh, no one else got it.
Let's get back to your,
Gene thought the same thing.
Gene,
I was working in his lab, he was doing the exact, he did the same thing. Once there was a professor for my machine visiting,
yeah,
and he introduced all of the procrastinators to me.
Yeah.
And they were like, oh, this is Kanye.
Yeah.
So it was
really
funny.
Any improvement?
Well, it's a weird combination how that worked out, honestly.
Yeah. I mean, it's Kanye.
Well, no, that's true.
Okay, yes. I feel like around here, probably.
Should I try one more
yeah.
thing?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
There's a guy, his girlfriend, she's Chinese, I think. It's spelled Y-U-G-E.
Yeah,
it says something in Chinese, but it sounds like huge, like how Trump pronounces huge.
Well, I don't know if I can see my presentation here.
So I was like,
you should be able to
see
it.
This is very awkward. That's
fine.
Bad
line. But to give me, or you have to do the arrangement over there.
Right, yeah.
Next thing, you need someone with, like, Tremendous or something, with a name like Tremendous.
Big
League. You'll be set for life on jokes.
You can probably
be very careful when you name your kids.
Yeah. I mean, especially if you're from a foreign country, you can't really expect how it's going to be pronounced. Like,
different
language,
you know?
Yeah, you don't even expect your dog to stand up in a foreign country.
Yeah, it could be like offensive.
Yeah.
Hey, how are you?
Because there's person was doing a lot of Einstein condensation studies.
That's way better.
I ended up working for someone who was trying to do fundamental symmetry measurements, which are very
It's still on the list, but
that's right.
about it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I had to write them all.
Me too.
Yep.
You start on the 7? Like,
now
it's
good.
Now it's good.
Sure.
Like,
okay, so here we can start.
I've
seen this from my students, you know, I use iPhones to do this. So, it's a great pleasure to welcome Paula to CIFM Seminar Series. Paula is Esther and Harold Edgerton, Associate Professor of Nuclear Engineering and Science Engineering at MIT. She actually got a PhD at MIT as well in 2006, and then she was both here, mainly working at Harvard Law School, also collaborated with many other people in the dime community here. And in 2009, she started at MIT as a faculty, and she was just promoted tenure in spring, so congratulations. Paul has done a lot of nice work in dime on magnetometry and spin physics and information science, and she's going to tell us a bit about this today. Welcome.
Thank you. Yeah. Thanks a lot, Marco, for the invitation. So because I sort of know that everybody knows already everything about diamond, so I'm not going to talk about diamond today. And hopefully you will be as well interested. So before I really start talking about some questions about how we can use nuclear spin to study some fundamental properties of incandescent matter, such as transport and localization, I actually want to do the thing which I will forget at the end, which is to acknowledge the main person who did most of the work, which is my graduate student, Ken. He has done some amazing work on that. And we also are collaborating with Shekhar Ramanathan at Dartmouth and Satellite at MIT. So what is the general motivation behind this work? So in my group, we work a lot using spins, and one of the main workhorses which we have is the NV Center in Diamond, that I think that you all are quite familiar with. But if you want to use the NV not only as a very nice magnetometer, which a lot of people are using, but also maybe as the basis for some type of quantum computation architecture, we need, of course, to scale up the system. And then a lot of problems start sort of appearing. So instead of just trying to scale up directly the system, we're sort of trying to build some first building blocks and then trying to connect them. So the building blocks will be, as I say, the NV center with some nearby nuclear spin so that you can do some small quantum computation very locally. But then you don't want to put NV center too close to each other, one, because probably it's difficult without creating too much damage to the diamond, and two, because there is, in any case, some limitation in how well you can address them. So you typically address them optically, and so there is a limitation. Even if you use super resolution techniques, you cannot go much more down than, let's say, 20, 30 nanometers, and that's already quite pushing it. So how do you connect distant NV centers? One thing that you can do is to use other systems inside your diamond, so other spins, for example, to connect them. So another path, of course, is instead to have very distant NV and then just use photons to connect them. So here, if you want to sort of bridge some much smaller distances than, like, let's say, kilometers, as people have done to demonstrate, for example, Bell test, what you might use are other spins inside the diamond. So as I said, part of the work that we do in my group is to work on developing control for these quantum registers. But today, I'm going to focus more on this idea of how we can use other spins to connect the register themselves. And this cartoonish picture by now is a bit old. I think maybe it dates back to 2009 or something like that. But actually, this is coming very much becoming more and more a reality. So for example, this is a recent work done, done by Dirk Englund at MIT, in which we were able to implant with very high precision through, through mask nitrogen and then convert them, or at least some of them, to NV centers. And inside this sort of line, we are able to implant one or more NV centers. But you typically have some residual nitrogen, because the conversion from nitrogen to NV is not perfect. And so these residual nitrogen, you cannot see them optically, but they are still spins. So they could be used as an additional system to connect your faraway quantum registers. And so really, this nitrogen spin can act as a spin wires. There are, of course, a lot of challenges to try to achieve this type of project. So first of all, although the spin will interact with each other, not all possible interaction will actually drive transport. You could have just diffusion. You could have just no transport at all. So we might need to try to engineer the Hamiltonian, engineer the interaction so that they actually do achieve transport and hopefully even ballistic transport, although I've been told that I should not say that word. It would get me in trouble with visa granting agency, as we were discussing at lunch. Apparently, it's very dangerous. But we would like to achieve a very simple transport and the most the fastest transport possible. The other thing that you would like to do is, if you have an initial excitation, let's say on your first qubit here, is to transfer it perfectly to the end of the chain. And again, you might need to sort of engineer what is the type of interaction that you have for that to happen. If you just let the system evolve, this transformation probably is not going to happen on its own. So you need a lot of control in order to achieve this type of things. Another problem is that, of course, this is my cartoonish picture of my spin chain. But in the more realistic picture, like in this one, probably the position of your implantation is not exactly precise. You will have, I don't know, this one is a bit more far away, closer to this one, and a bit more distance to the previous one. And so there is some problem with disorder in the spin position, and also the addition of other environmental effects, which also create a disorder at the location of each one of the spins. So we might also have a local disorder and more generally decoherence. So what are all the effects of this on the transport? So if you want to achieve this quantum transport, maybe that's another challenge to achieve this type of goal. So to try to start answering this first question, how can we drive spin transport, one of the Hamiltonian that people have considered, so one of the interaction, is this interaction here. So the idea is very simple. So if you have a spin pair, one pointing up and the other is pointing down, this type of Hamiltonian with plus and minus basically flip-flop each other. Okay, so it can change the state from one to the other. And then once you have done this on the first pair, you can now exchange the spin with the next pair, et cetera, et cetera. And so you will transfer your excitation down the chain. These happen nicely because these are energy-conserving transition. And so you might expect to indeed have some type of a ballistic transport. However, what we typically have is not this type of Hamiltonian, which is the so-called XX Hamiltonian in condensed matter, but it's some other Hamiltonian. I wrote it down here in a slightly weird way. This is the so-called XXZ Hamiltonian. It's basically the dipole, the magnetic dipole-dipole Hamiltonian that you will have between two spins, but I truncate all the parts which do not conserve the total magnetization. So the idea is that if you have some larger magnetic field, larger than the coupling, this is the only part of the Hamiltonian which is left over. So this Hamiltonian contains something which looks like this, but also some other terms which do not drive transport, and actually add some additional phase to your evolution, and that hampers the transport. So instead of having transport, you actually have just diffusion. So how can we try to regain the Hamiltonian that we would like for transport if instead we have this? So one of the tools that we use, this type of tool a lot in my group, is to really try to apply what I call Hamiltonian engineering. So we have some initial Hamiltonian, and we would like to find some final target Hamiltonian. And what we do is to add control. So the control that we add is typically in the form of short pulses or resonance with the spin transition frequency themselves. So in this case, for nuclear spin, for example, it's a radio frequency. For electronic spin, it would be microwave frequency. And so what we do is the following. Assume that this Hamiltonian is, as I say, the conserve the total magnetization along Z. So I can somehow represent it as this arrow along Z. And then if I do a pi over 2 along the y direction, it's as if I would rotate my total Hamiltonian along around the y direction and down to the x-axis. So you will have that your new Hamiltonian looks like this arrow here. And the shape of this Hamiltonian, now the dipolar Hamiltonian, if you want, along x, looks like the same terms, this first one, minus this term which we do not want. So if I keep going back and forward between the two, so between this one and this one for a lot of time, by repeating these pulses here, on average, what I get is the Hamiltonian in between. Okay? And the Hamiltonian in between is nothing else than the Hamiltonian which I want. So I just need to tune nicely this timing so that indeed I have twice this term minus once the other one. And so the average Hamiltonian is the one that we want. So we can use this type of techniques to take an Hamiltonian, which is what nature gives us, and simulate another Hamiltonian that we would like. So if you want this Hamiltonian engineering technique, it's a very good tool in order to do what it's called analytical quantum simulation. So you don't use like a computer to write gates to simulate some other physical problem. You use one physical problem to emulate a different physical problem, which you might be more interested or which is more difficult to observe in its natural system. So we push this type of technique of Hamiltonian engineering also to deal with other variation at the nanoscale. So I'm not really going to talk about this. It's just if you want a little bit of advertisement. So what we did was several works in trying sort of to not only tune the Hamiltonian, but also change the couplings among the spins so that you can achieve ideal transport. So with the simple Hamiltonian which I wrote here, you will get ballistic transport, but you don't get perfect fidelity or transferring initial excitation at one end of this, the chain to the other end of the chain. If instead you use this type of techniques and modulate also the couplings so that they are not all equal to each other, but they have some particular shape, then you would actually get perfect transport. And so, for example, what you would get is something like this. So again, I have an initial excitation at one end of my chain, and I would like to transfer it on the other side. So here I plot the direction of my spins in a more classical way, if you want. And here I'm also plotting what is the fidelity of the excitation being on the fourth spin and then on each one of the other spins. And as time goes on, you can see that it transfers, and then at some point, the excitation is all transferred to the other end of the chain. And of course, if you let time go on for longer, it just bounces back and forward in this chain. So you have to select the exact time at which, let's see if I can, it doesn't run anymore, at which you can actually find the perfect transfer on the other side. So this only happens when you have this type of coupling here, which, as I said, we can achieve with this technique of Hamiltonian engineering. However, again, this is a very idealized situation, with theoretical spins. So what we would like to do is first to find a system in which we can start simulating these type of problems, and then also address this other question that we had about what happens if I have disordered coherence and so on and so forth, so generally imperfections in the system itself. So it would be nice to work with nice chains of NV centers and P1, so nitrogen residual defects. But until now, the precision with which people were implanting and generating this chain was not good enough. So I think that hopefully in the next few years, we will be able to start working with this other system. So to sort of avoid that problem and have spins which are really positioned in very, very precise location, we decide to look at a different type of system. Yes, sure.
Do you drive all the spins simultaneously, or do you require individual?
Yeah, so because of our experimental capabilities for the type of system that we consider, we are always assuming that I can only drive all the spins together. So the idea is that, in some sense, I'm trying to do these quantum wires. If I were able to really address each one of the spin in the quantum wires, well, I would just use it as a qubit. So it must mean that there is like less control. Maybe I can only address all of them together. I can initialize them. I can read them out. Otherwise, they would be perfect qubits. And so yes, the control is all collective. Yeah, thanks. Very good question. And again, we try out this type of control using NMR techniques, so nuclear magnetic resonance techniques, because they give us quite a bit of advantages. So first of all, the spins and this regular crystal, so I don't have disorder in the position. And so what I might be able to do is to take a known system, this nuclear spin system, add some control, and then simulate some target quantum system, so achieve this analog quantum simulation. And the advantages are this well-defined geometry, but really the main advantage is that we have very good control on the system. So we rely on these 60 years of control techniques that NMR people have developed, and then add our new ones that we come up with these other new goals in mind. But we can get a lot of inspiration from what people have done in the past. Also, the coherence times are quite long, because nuclear spin do not interact very much with the external world, and so they typically live for quite a long time. So we have typically long times to see them interact with each other before external noise and decoherence kicks in. There is this challenge, of course, that we don't have single spin addressability. So we cannot control them individually, and also we cannot measure them individually. And so this sort of challenges us and come up with some new ways of both controlling and detecting quantities of interest. So this is actually a picture of my magnet, which is actually a very old magnet, older than probably most of you in this room. It's from 83, so you laugh, but it's true. We do experiment on a lot, on toothpaste, on a sort of weird material. So this is just like a natural mineral, which has this type of lattice structure. It's called fluorapatite. And we typically just use single crystals. And we use a bit of synthetic crystals, but we also use a lot of just natural crystal like this one. So this one was actually a pendant, which I bought on eBay for $10. And it does like very, very nice experiments. You can also find it in toothpaste, because it contains fluorine, which is good for your teeth. And it's also a material that people use for bone implant. So it's also a material which is studied for biomedical applications. So why do we use this material? OK, it has fluorine spins, OK, which is 100% abundant with spin 1/2. So it's nice to be used. But the most important thing is the lattice structure here. So the lattice structure basically is hexagonal, with the atoms in the vertical direction, which are very close to each other, while the side of the hexagon are quite long. So if I consider more than one lattice and I put on top of each other, what you start seeing emerging is a chain in the vertical direction of spins which are very close to each other, and they do not interact too much with its companion chain on the other side. So because the coupling goes as the cube of the distance, the in-chain coupling is 40 times stronger than the coupling among chains. So for relevant time scales, the system really looks like a 1D system. And so this simplifies a lot the dynamics that we have, and we can understand it better than a full 3D system. So it's a good playground to start understanding this type of dynamics, and in particular, it's a good playground for the simulation of information transfer in chains. Basically, our system is almost an infinite ensemble of parallel chains, which are typically quite long, so we never see really the other end of the chain. And so we can consider all of them as equivalent, even if they might have different lengths. And the chains themselves are interrupted because there are defects, for example, protons substituting at the place of a fluorine, emitting fluorine, some paramagnetic defects, which give this yellow color instead of the white color, which you would have naturally. What we also have is an intrinsic source of disorder. So these yellow spheres here are actually phosphorus 34, which also has a spin 1/2. So we have, if you want, a local source of magnetic field given by this phosphorus at the location of each one of the fluorine spins here. And in addition, we also have other defects, as I say, paramagnetic center. So we want to use this system, and in particular, initially focusing on this fluorine, in order to study these ideas of quantum transport. So the first thing really to verify is, do we have good enough control? Do we have good enough coherence properties? And can we really see something which looks like a 1D system? So if I just start from the thermal state, all the experiments are done at room temperature, so nuclear spin are in a very highly mixed state. So you only have a small polarization, which is on the order of 10 to the minus 5, so a very tiny signal, but you have a lot of them. Then what I can do is just to do an excitation, so do a pi over 2 pulse to put them a spin in the transverse plane and see the dynamics. It's a radio frequency. Yes. Yeah, so it's on the order of 300 megahertz in the magnetic field, which is 7 tesla. So we do a pi over 2 pulse, which takes less than 1 microsecond, and then we start looking at the precession. Because the spin are interacting with each other quite strongly on the order of tens of kilohertz, more or less 8, 10 kilohertz, the signal actually decays down very quickly. So what you see is really this apparent decay with coherence time of less than 100 microseconds, which doesn't sound very good. I just told you that we should have quite long coherence time. But the problem is that what I'm observing is really the interaction among all the spins. So if I start modifying my Hamiltonian so that I'm controlling this interaction, I can see much longer coherence time. So I can see oscillation which go on for about 1 or 2 milliseconds. And really, the limit, if you want, on this coherence time is more the pulse error which I'm introducing and the approximation to the Hamiltonian that I'm trying to achieve, and not an intrinsic coherence time itself. So here, what I was applying is really this sequence, which I show you, this alternating between Z and X of my the polar Hamiltonian. And the other nice thing is that I can actually fit this to a very simple model, which is a one-dimensional chain with only nearest neighbor coupling. And so this is like this dashed line. You can see the fit is very well. So of course, my system is not one-dimensional. It doesn't have just nearest neighbor coupling. But this approximation, given the time scale, is pretty good. And so really, I can treat this as a collection of 1D spin chain. And so now I'm in business. I can start looking at these ideas of transport and localization. So in particular, what we were interested most recently was really to look at effects of disorder on the transport itself. So we've done in the past some work on really just looking at transport, how to transfer actually quantum information using these completely mixed spin chains. But then we sort of decided, OK, up until now, we erased by doing the coupling, like spin echo, the effects of the disorder. Now let's introduce it back and see what happens. So what happens is somehow the following thing. So again, I can show you what would be the evolution, the transport of my initial excitation. But then I can show you with light colors what happens if I have no disorder. And instead, the dark colors are what happens when I add the disorder to the system. As you can see, although the light one keep bouncing back and forward, so you still have transport, now this other one, you only have excitation, which is always localized at the very beginning. So as soon as I turn on disorder, I cannot have transport anymore, which is pretty bad if your goal is indeed having transport. So we might have to develop ways of trying to take care of that. But on the flip side, now I have the following scenario. I created some local excitation, and adding disorder, I can actually preserve it there. So instead now of having a quantum wire, what I'm developing is something which is similar, more similar to a quantum memory. And if, for example, I'm even able to turn on and off the disorder, I could store for some time my memory and then let it transport the information and then stop it again by just adding disorder. So it could be like a very nice way of sort of going from a sort of transport scenario to a memory scenario. Yes? So what we're considering is to add at each location of each spin a random magnetic field. So I'm going to show in a bit like the formula for the Hamiltonian if you want to see them. But yes, it's, each spin has its own local magnetic field. And so the resonance frequency of each spin now is slightly different. And so this energy conserving flip-flop cannot happen anymore because they're not on resonance anymore. And so you cannot have this transport. They just stay all localized.
So these sort of these P tunes then, the
same. Exactly. Okay. Exactly.
So we can just know.
Yeah. So this, as I say, this has possibly some good application in terms of quantum. Yes.
Fluorines, are they all pointed in the same? They're in a line, and so they don't have strings.
So there, so the crystal, we orient the crystal parallel to the magnetic field. So then the chains are all aligned with the magnetic field.
And then
the spins, they are in a thermal state. So again, because they're in a large magnetic field, they can be typically either up or down, at least a thermal equilibrium. And then during the evolution, they take all possible directions. So besides this possible application, which, okay, we will have to see if it's really practical, but I think it's quite interesting, it also has some more fundamental implications. Okay. So when we consider to create some excitation locally, and then see this, how it propagates in larger quantum system, what the system does is effectively to go from a real, if you want, even ground state pure system with a local excitation to something which, to all effects, look like as if it were a thermal state. So something which go from a quantum system to something which looks more like a classical system. And this type of phenomena really happens when we start looking at larger and larger systems. So now, adding disorder might be a way of actually trying to quench this thermalization process. And so since a lot of us are in the business of trying to use quantum system for their quantum property, then it becomes very interesting to try to study any type of effects which might help in preserving the quantumness of large quantum systems instead of just going back to the usual and somehow boring statistical, classical statistical mechanics and thermalization. And more generally, what one might try to answer are questions such as, if I have a closed quantum system, how does it become at some point thermal and really exhibit these classical properties? What is the role of disorder? And if I have long-range interaction, what is the role of this interaction in either quenching this thermalization process or enhancing it or enabling it and so on and so forth? And generally, we really want to control larger and larger quantum systems. And so these ideas that when you have large quantum system which is all interacting, it becomes much, much easier to find yourself in this thermalized classical state. Maybe is there some limiting control in how we tune or not disorder and interaction, how we can control it, which will help us in controlling these larger and larger quantum systems. So this is sort of like more fundamental type of question that we would like to try to answer with our system. So what is really the Hamiltonian that we have? So here I'm sort of rewriting down that same dipolar interaction which I had before in a more standard form. So you still have these XX and YY that you had before, and now I only write it down in terms of some sigma ZZ. So it's exactly the same, just wrote it down something similar. And then I also have the coupling of my fluorine spin, which I still call with my polymatrices, to the phosphorus spin, or maybe some parametric impurity, which I call as with this letter S. So this coupling, basically, if I treat this spin as just some classical magnetic field, which is either pointing up or down, because they're thermal again, in practice, what it does is to introduce a magnetic field which varies with position. So what we use is, again, these techniques, the same that I showed you before, to try to average out the natural Hamiltonian by using control in order to find another Hamiltonian, which, if you want the technical term nowadays, is a Floquet Hamiltonian, so it's periodic Hamiltonian, which is more interesting from our point of view. So what we would like to have is a part which is integrable, so which will drive the transfer of this perturbation into your system. And then we also want to add some interaction, which really go beyond, it sort of makes the model no longer exactly solvable, but it creates some more interaction among different spins. So this term would be the same as an excitation, like an electro excitation, fermionic excitation hopping from one brace to the other due to tunneling, and this one is an additional interaction. And then finally, we also want to have disorder. So as I say, we want to use these techniques to try to find this Hamiltonian or extract this Hamiltonian from what nature gives us. So what we can do is, of course, to get the disorder parts of this local magnetic field just from this interaction to other spins. So that's somehow easy. So typically, we can actually erase this quite easily or introduce it or modulate it to change what is the interaction strength. then what we can do is to use this type of sequences, and you might recognize the basic unit or the one which I showed before. So this is just like repeating many times with some phase cycling, which some people working with NV Center may be familiar with, to just make your approximation better. It looks more impressive than just two poses. That's why I show it. So with this type of technique, we can achieve, for example, this type of integrable Hamiltonian. Actually, we achieve one which is slightly different as a minus sign here. But to all effects, it's really the same. We cannot really get only this interaction. What we can get is this, which is nothing else, again, than your original dipolar Hamiltonian. So instead of canceling it out completely, we just leave it a little bit. So in order to get all of this, what we do is to change the timing between the pulses, which is something new that NMR people didn't really think of. But if you change the timing among pulses, you can sort of tune these three Hamiltonian and then with different weights. So you can have just this one, add a little bit of this, decrease this one, add more or less disorder. So all these parameters, U, V, and G, they're all tunable by us. So we can really play around a lot with what we can do with the system. So again, what we would like to do, what we would like then to measure. So the idea is the following. So I would like to have some initial local excitation. And what I'm interested in is to know if this excitation is propagating in my system or if it stays local. So what I can do is to define a quantity which I would call the correlation length, which will measure over which length my excitation has propagated. So as a function of time, I would observe the following. In a system without disorder, my excitation sort of get distributed among many, many spins. So the correlation length is increasing. But then when I add disorder here, now this excitation cannot be transported anymore. So I expect that my correlation length will be much shorter, and it's shorter to what people usually call the localization length, or Xi. Okay, so this is for people who also know about this Anderson localization, et cetera. It's a typical symbol. I don't know exactly why. So as I said, we cannot really measure individual spin. So I cannot go ahead and say, OK, let's measure spin number 3, 4, 5, et cetera, and see if they share the excitation or not. So I want to rely on some collective property of my system in order to know how far away the correlation has gone. So I can do the following trick. I can say, OK, I will write down my density matrix, which is representing my initial mixed state. And then I can just write it down as a sum of operators which contain a given number of possible excitation. So for example, this element here in my density matrix corresponds to a k-body term. So it's something which contains, for example, k sigma z, and all the other spin are in the identity state. Okay. Or it could be something which contain k minus 2 sigma z, 2 sigma x, and then all the other one are identity state. So in general, I will have something which has L minus k, where L is the length of my chain, identity states, and everything else is somehow correlated. So this type of states really tell me about is the excitation propagating in my system or not. So I can sort of subdivide my state based on this notion of how many bodies are correlated inside the state itself. And I can then define my correlation length as just the sum, or if you want, the average number of correlation itself. So if I call F the weight, if you want, of all the k-body term, then my correlation length is nothing else than the weight of the k-body terms times k. So this gives me, on average, since I have a trauma system, I can only talk of averages, how much my correlation has really propagated. So we are interested in this type of metric, one, because it sort of links nicely to this intuitive picture of what correlation should do in either a localized or in a non-localized system, and also because it correlates to other metrics that people have proposed in order to study this phenomenon of localization. And in particular, what people have been studying has been entanglement. So of course, entanglement tells you how much you are correlated inside your system. So this is, there are, of course, many different types of possible entanglement that you can measure. But they all somehow, in a sort of equivalent way, are still a matrix of this localization. So So here what I'm doing is, for example, plotting our metric, the correlation length, which is the dashed line, and I'm comparing it to a metric of entanglement, which is the mutual information. So this is just the mutual information between two halves of my chain. And as you can see, the two really fall on top of each other, even if, of course, I need to rescale the mutual information itself, because it would be very, very small for our system, which is at very high temperature. So the main important thing is that the typical localized system, after initial growth of the correlation or the mutual information, will sort of saturate. Okay, so if the system is localized, you don't expect to have any correlation grow anymore. But now, if I actually add also additional interactions, then what I have is that actually my my correlation length or the mutual information can keep growing. The growth is, however, quite slow. So here the time is in logarithmic unit. So what you have is a logarithmic growth of entanglement. So even if you don't have transport anymore, once you add interaction, you still have a little bit of entanglement which keeps growing in your system. So your system is not completely localized, but the entanglement is growing. It's, however, growing very, very slowly, because this long-range interaction cannot really achieve full transport, but can still link a few pairs of spins, make them, if you want, resonant again. And so you can have this correlation propagate a bit farther. So how can we detect this in our system? So what we can do is to use some old NMR technique. As I say, we are inspired a lot by NMR, in which people for a long time in NMR were interested in really knowing how your structure of a molecule or of a protein is determined. So how can you know if two spins that you observe are actually close by or they're far away? Well, if you start seeing that you're having these two spins correlated, it means that they must be close enough. So to know what is the size of a nearby cluster of spins, what you can measure is how many spins correlate in your system. And this is very similar to what we want to measure in some sense. So this is, as you say, very old techniques, but we can still put it to very good use. So what are these multiple quantum coherences? So what I'm doing here is, again, to plot my density matrix, but now just using a different basis. Okay? And so each one of these terms here now correspond to what we call a coherence. So let's say that, for example, you have a coherent superposition between two eigenstates of the total sigma z operator. So one with n spin pointing up and all the other pointing down, and the other one with m spin pointing up and all the other pointing down. If I rotate my state by a collective sigma z rotation, the two eigenstates will acquire a different phase, which is proportional to the difference between m and n, so something like this. I can, of course, rewrite this state down also in form of density matrix form, so as a matrix. And so what I will have, okay, here I raise this correspondent on this without the phase, I will have these cross off-diagonal terms. Okay? And so we call this off-diagonal term, which correspond to this red and square and blue square, we call them coherence element in the matrix itself. These two elements will be somewhere here on the diagonal. So again, these terms really correspond to the fact that inside your state you have some coherences. Okay. Of course, however, I can subdivide my whole matrix in terms of all elements which have a given coherence number, as given by the difference between n and m. So this is not a full basis, but I can still subdivide my density matrix in this way. And each one of these terms will again acquire a phase which is proportional to this n minus m. So this Q, which is the coherence number. And so because of that, I've been able to measure the intensity of each one of these terms by just using this collective rotation, which I can do in my system. And so what I measure is typically this so-called MQC intensity, which are just the weight, if you want, of each Q term in my density matrix. So what I would really like to do is to have some link between this representation, because this is what I can measure, and this other representation in terms of how many spins are inside the state, because this is what gives me the localization length. Unfortunately, if I have a coherence of order Q, this has to have at least Q spins, Okay, but it could also have 2q spins. It could have 100 spins, even if q is very small. So there is not a one-to-one correspondence, but it's a one-to-many correspondence between these two pictures. So it doesn't seem very promising. But because we know very well our system, and because it's a 1D system in which we can really solve, at least in the ideal nearest neighbor case, we were actually able to find a very direct relationship between the multiple quantum intensity and the intensity of the k-body terms in the state itself. So using this relationship, we can then measure experimentally what is this correlation length, and so tell us if we are creating very long correlation or instead if our system is more localized. So we first test this just doing a simulation, a numerical simulation. And indeed, you can see that even when we add additional interaction, which are not comprised in our model where we actually have this exact relationship, the approximation is still good. So of course, when I don't have an interaction, which is like this black line, the correspondence between measuring the correlation length with MQC and with the exact model is perfect. And when I start adding also the interaction, it's still pretty good. So which means that really experimentally, I can indeed measure my correlation length. And so that's what we did. So the first thing that we did was to look at so-called Anderson localization, which is a localization which happens when you don't have interaction among your spins. So when I say interaction, are these longer range interaction, not like the local one. And so in that case, what you see is that as we increase the disorder strength, the system gets more and more localized. So initially, this correlation length keep increasing. And then it starts quenching out at a shorter and shorter time and a lower and lower levels. So the more disorder you have, the more localized your system becomes. Now what happens when I add again the interaction? So again, what I see is that initially, the correlation length increases, but then if I have no interaction, it saturates out. Here, the time is in a logarithmic scale. And then when I start adding some interaction, the localization length keeps increasing. And it shows something which, although I only have 4 points here, it somehow look linear on this logarithmic scale. So it should really represent this logarithmic increase of this correlation length, which is the signature of many-body localization. So unfortunately, we cannot go much longer in time, but it really looks like these last few points are really linear in this logarithmic strength, in this logarithmic scale. So this is one of the first observations of this phenomenon of many-body localization in a natural system. And one of the advantages of our system is that really it is, as I say, like it's just like a crystal, which I bought on eBay. So you can really observe this fundamental quantum phenomena by just looking at something which would occur naturally in nature. So the other thing that we can do is also to link this quantity that we can detect with multiple quantum coherences to matrix which detect more generally this idea of information scrambling inside a system. So as I say, when you have a local perturbation by just the evolution of your system, you expect it to sort of propagate everywhere. So if you have initially a local perturbation, if you want local information in your system, very quickly it just gets mixed out in all your system. So this is called scrambling on information itself. And what one wants to measure typically is the following effect. So let's say that I have some initial perturbation which is local. And so this will, of course, commute, like this perturbation here. This will, of course, commute with any operator which is far away. But now if the perturbation is traveling during time, then now this, the perturbation after some time will have propagated over a certain number of spins or position or atoms, et cetera. And so it will not commute anymore with a local operator which is far away. So really what you want to know is this commutator really commuting at times larger than zero? So you would like to measure this quantity, this commutator square. And what we found was really a connection between this commutator, in particular, we have to fix A to B, always the total magnetization along Z, and the quantum coherences, which we can measure in our experiments. And so this can be now a new tool to look at many different questions. So we can look, as I said, quantum information scrambling, we can look at quantum criticality, we can look at quantum chaos, again, localization, and so on and so forth. So it's a new tool which will allow us to explore many different things. So I think that, like, I will show very, very quickly the results that we got in the past 2 weeks, in which we'll start looking at quantum criticality and then just stop here because I'm already talking too much. So what we looked at was, as an example, a quantum criticality in the transverse Ising model. So if you only have, this is given by this Hamiltonian, and if you only have this part of the Hamiltonian, your ground state will have all the spin pointing up, so you will be some kind of paramagnet. If you only have this red part of the Hamiltonian, then all the spin will want to point either in the plus x direction or in the minus x direction, so it is a ferromagnet. And then, of course, when you have both of them, you will have a transition from one to the other. And the critical point is when this g, this factor multiplying your magnetic field, is equal to 1. And so what we would like to do is to try to use this idea of this commutator in order to study this critical point. In simulation, indeed, we see that if we plot the commutator as a function of the transverse field, at the critical point, here I even plotted with the wrong, okay, I'm very sorry, this axis is actually shifted by and multiplied by 2. But the critical point should be 1, except that this is 1, 2, et cetera, et cetera. Sorry, it's a 0.25, 0.5, 1, et cetera. So at this critical point, we see this, this maximum of our commutator. And the idea is, again, if you are in these two limiting cases, so all you spin up, all you spin down, you don't have any propagation of information. Well, at this critical point, the spin do not know what to do. So they want to be either all aligned up or all aligned in the x direction. And because they do not know what to do, if you want the information, the perturbation will propagate much, much faster. And so you really have this phase transition, which you can even see, even if our system is effectively almost at a high, almost infinite temperature. So this type of phase transition typically is observed only at zero temperature, but here we are able also to see it at this very high temperature. And so we also did this experimentally, and we cannot really do the Ising model. We do the XXZ model, which is very similar. And again, in the experiment, we also see this peak at our critical field, which is, again, around 1, in this metric that we can measure by using these multiple quantum coherences. So this is, as I say, a preliminary experiments, which also show that this novel way of looking through these multiple quantum coherences is going to be a very important tool to study this type of phenomena. Okay, so this brings me to my conclusions. So what we did was to really use these nuclear spin systems in order to study this phenomenon of transport. And the initial motivation was really to try to simulate quantum information transport inside these quantum spin wires. But what we found was that really the system allows us to explore a much broader range of topics in physics. So of course, one might be able to achieve quantum information transfer in a distributed quantum computer, but also we are able to simulate very interesting quantum phenomena. So not only we can build, if you want, quantum wires, but also just a quantum simulator out of our nuclear spins. And we can study things such as localization, chaos, thermalization, information scrambling, which is related, for example, to black holes, and so on and so forth. And the main tools that we use were Hamiltonian engineering, so this way of taking the Hamiltonian which nature gives us and transform it into some other more interesting Hamiltonian for our goals, and also with a tunability of the various parameters of the Hamiltonian itself. And then the second tool was to look at correlation among spins, which are apparent when we measure this quantum coherence, these multiple quantum coherences. In particular, we use this quasi-1D system, which simplifies the dynamics, although now we are also in the process of looking at 3D systems where some of the, most of the method will carry through, but it will also give more interesting dynamics yet. So the main message here is actually that our system is much more complex than the model that we use to analyze it. So for the moment, we were really saying, OK, everything looks as if it were a 1D system. with nearest neighbor interaction only. And we use that to analyze our experimental results. But actually, the system is more complex. It's really a full 3D system. It has long-range interaction. And so all of this brings an additional complexity, which really makes the system something that people cannot simulate on classical computer, that people cannot really solve with analytical model. And so now we are really in the position that we understand the approximation, and we can now go beyond that and really exploit and try to discover some novel physics that people are not able to answer with either theory or numerics. And so I think that this is really important. Again, these are the people which have contributed to this. And the rest of the group is mostly working on the MB Center. So you can see I didn't talk about most of the things that I do in my group, but it's quite recent work, and I find it very, very exciting. So thank you very much. So, like, we haven't really done experiments, but like, the thing that we have in mind is to use the P1 center, so like the nitrogen electronic spins, because they're more strongly coupled. So, like, for our crystal, the distance is on the order of angstrom, but with implantation, you probably will have something like a few nanometers. So then the Kabli-Among spin will be too weak. I mean, spin, nuclear spin would be quite nice because they have longer coherence time. But then you would be battling with very weak coupling. So what we were thinking is to couple to electronic spins, which are left over from implantation.
You were talking about quantum coherence at very long time scales, at least one of the slides showed. So, and that was essentially at low temperatures?
So everything is done at room temperature.
And you are able to get quantum
coherence? So, I mean, nuclear spin, coherence property are not so much affected by temperature. So their intrinsic energy is so low that unless you go to like nanoKelvin, temperature doesn't really change what's going on for them. Okay, millikelvin probably enough. So yeah, like everything is in a highly thermal state. The coherence is mostly like, the relaxation is mostly limited by coupling to phonons, but the relaxation times for like this natural crystal is on the order of a few seconds, but for synthetic crystal is on the order of minutes, which sounds good, but actually is a drawback because then it takes forever to average out your signal. So like relaxation is not so much a problem. The coherence time is mainly limited really by the interaction of the spins with each other. And so if you just let your system evolve under the natural interaction, it looks like everything is mixing up very quickly. But it's still a coherent evolution, except that you don't see whatever, you cannot measure whatever states are created because you only see local observables, if you want. So if you can modify your Hamiltonian so that you erase this coupling, then you can achieve this much longer coherence times.
First one, do you include, I know it's like first approximation, it's fine to not include the effect of in coupling between different chains in the crystal, but when you're doing some other simulations, sort of,
yeah.
Do you see any effect from that?
So we did a work by now, I don't know, 2009 or something like this, in which we were really trying to study effects which were beyond this naive 1D nearest neighbor model. And so what we saw was that, yes, you start seeing effects coming from the next nearest neighbor coupling, which are 1/8 of your like strongest coupling, and also the effects of the surrounding chains. That happens sort of beyond the time scale that we have looked at in this work. So typically, it's not too bad. Some of the discrepancy that we see in this work with respect to the ideal model comes from the fact that, okay, like that boundary is not like up to here, you don't see anything, and then you see something. So yeah, so all these effects at some point become important. And that's really what I'm saying here. But for the moment, in order to simplify our lives, especially numerical simulation, like it's difficult to simulate more than 20 spins. So if you start to have two chains, then you're already doubling the number of spins that you want to simulate. So for understanding what's going on, we just use this 1D chain, the nearest neighbor. But the system is more complicated. And a lot of interesting physics will emerge from this additional complication. So for example, like this many body localization has been well studied for 1D systems, but already for 2D and 3D systems, it's not even clear if it will happen or not. So by just orienting our crystal in a different direction, we can go from something which really looks like 1D to something which looks more like 2D, 3D, et cetera, et cetera. So I think that that's really what we want to do next and try to see additional effects coming from there.
What about combining these dynamics, or maybe not this system, but sort of making spin wires? I mean, what is the prospect of that in any system and coupling through shallow enemies?
Yeah, so I mean, I think that like this system is probably going to be difficult. I mean, you could think of just putting one crystal on top of diamond and see it around. But for example, people have started looking at these 2D materials and look at them with MV centers. So I think that it sounds really, really exciting because then you can still manipulate all the nuclear spins in the 2D material. Yeah, for example. Boron nitride, graphene, yes. You could have the spins there and then use the MV center as local probes. So that now you have something which is really 2D, for example, and you can possibly study this. So, yes.
Okay. You mentioned silicon might be an issue system for fabrication. What are the disadvantages of using silicon vacancies for this?
For silicon vacancy?
Yeah.
I'm not exactly sure. So silicon vacancy are good for like their optical properties. I mean, people are starting to see also much better spin properties by, for example, tuning strain, etc. But at the moment, I think that either MV centers or combination of other defects with MV center or nuclear spins for the spin properties are still better. This type of work, I think that I like my nuclear spins, maybe, as I was telling Marco, to go to a combination of MVs with other nuclear spin. For a lot of other things that people are interested for, which are more connected to photonics or maybe phononics, et cetera, then silicon vacancy seems to be better. Because the optical properties are typically better, yeah.
So when you go from nuclear spins to electronic spins, does the tweaking of the Hamiltonian become a lot tougher?
So in principle, no. Like the time scale are faster, but also the coupling to external control is faster. So it should be somehow the same. I think that like the main problem which I can see is that typically when you have electronic spins, you also have a lot of other defects. So for our crystal with nuclear spin, we have this nuclear, like the fluorine. The phosphorus, yes, they're there, but they have even smaller Gini-Mannitti ratio, so their frequency is even smaller, so the coupling is very weak. We can easily decouple them and erase them. For electronic spin, that is going to be a bit more difficult. So like when you try to create, for example, high density of NV centers, you also have high density of nitrogens. And so although controlling the NV center would be as easy as controlling this, you're in the presence of a much stronger bath, and that can complicate your life in the end. So there has been some work on these ideas of thermalization, et cetera, done with NV centers. But and they had like a very nice crystal in which I think they had 4 NVs per 1 nitrogen residual. But even there, they needed to use, instead of these pulse techniques, some continuous driving, because otherwise the coherence time was not long enough. So I think that like in terms of the coupling here, we have a bit better coherence times.
Any last questions? None? Right. Let's thank Paul again.